This is Rob Temple Boxing Social, delighted to be joined by Sam Jones. We're here today at BT Studios to announce Joe Joyce's, well, his next fight date, not quite his opponent
his
yet.
Second fight date after next week. Yeah, he's
his second fight
date. Yeah, he's fighting on May the 18th against Alexander Ustinov, and then hopefully if he gets through that, which I'm sure he will, July the 13th in a big fight.
Let's start with that, Alexander Ustinov. Yeah. I was shown some tweets where you called Ustinov the worst heavyweight in the world. Thoughts?
I also say Derby County are the best football team in the world. It doesn't mean it's actually happened. I said that about Stiverne as well. But look, he's got to be taken seriously. He's a big old lump with a massive head, and he's got to be taken seriously.
The last time we saw Ustinov in the ring, he got stopped by Michael Hunter. Yep. Is there any additional pressure on Joe Joyce to kind of one-up Hunter, as it were?
I don't think so, but Hunter nearly got the Anthony Joshua fight off the back of stopping Ustinov. So in 3 weeks' notice for Joe and Ustinov, it's not a bad fight to be made.
What kind of opponent are we looking at for July the 13th? This card, obviously, we're here to talk about Dubois Gorman as well as Joe. Yeah. Ajit Kabayel, Manuel Char, those two fights are considered the most likely, but as I understand it, there's certain stumbling blocks potentially in the way of both of them.
Yeah, ultimately, as I said, as Frank said, just reiterating what Frank said, there's two ways to get out of a fight. One, say you don't want it, and two, just price yourself out of it. The fight's been offered to Derek Chisora. He's been offering, I think, that's for seven figures, which is outrageous money. Big fan of Derek, do you know what I mean? He's done a lot for British boxing, but I just don't think he wants to fight Joe. Kabayel, he's allowed a voluntary defence. I believe the EBU's allowed him to have a voluntary defence. He wants a voluntary, I think, before July. And what I think he'll do is vacate the belt once he's won against somebody no one's ever heard of. I think that's what he'll do.
Would that leave Joe in line? So obviously he's mandatory to fight for the vacant belt.
He's also mandatory for the WBA regular, so that'll also put him in a great position.
Doesn't Joe hold the WBA global title?
Gold.
Gold, global, I don't know what it was. What's the WBA gold title?
That is a belt that is in the WBA. I know people say there's so many belts in the WBA, but listen, you won it, and he's above the ranking system, and the WBA puts him in a good position.
Now, obviously, Joe had been mooted to be potentially facing Daniel Dubois. Yeah. That was ordered by the British Boxing Board of Control. Just tell me why that fight didn't happen and how we ended up with Dubois, Gorman, and obviously Joyce versus TBA.
It's simple, really. Joe's mandatory for the European title. If Joe was to fight for the British title, he'd lose his mandatory position in the European. We're not going to go back down to fight for a British title after coming off a win against Bermaine Stiverne, whose last one was against Wilder. We're ranked one, like above the ranking system in the WBA, top 15 in the WBC. We're not going to go back down to that level. In fact, but the fight's always going to be there with Dubois and Gorman. Joe's promoted by this, got the same promoter, and it's a fight that can happen either by the end of the year or early next year.
It's the first time I've spoken to you since the change to Adam Booth, obviously, yeah, with Abel Sanchez. Just your thoughts, well, why did that happen? Just the reasons behind that.
We wanted Adam Booth originally. We wanted Adam Booth originally, but he was not available at the time. So as soon as Adam Booth became available, we went.
How does that kind of leave it? Because as I understand it, you got on well with Abel Sanchez, performed well.
He coaches my other heavyweight, Guido Vianello, who was a Rio 2016 Olympian. So he's happy there. But with Joe needed something else, we've already seen the improvements that Joe's made under Adam. And you will see some of those improvements on May the 18th next week, and then you'll see all of the improvements on July the 13th.
It's three trainers and eight fights for Joe. Three very different trainers as well, obviously, Salas, Sanchez and Adam Booth. It's quite an unusual mix for somebody who's 8-0.
Well, when Joe turned professional, he signed with David Hay, and he inherited Ismael Salas, who's trained 19 world champions. So we can hardly turn something like that down at Joe's stage. Ismael Salas went into semi-retirement. So we need to, Joe's 33. We can't just go around gym to gym pondering which train. We need to move quickly with Joe. It's not like an ordinary situation. So we got up to a Big Bear. We did some training there. Joe had two fights in America. Did his profile the world a good. Was a televised fight on Showtime on the Tyson Fury Wilder undercard with Abel Sanchez. But ultimately, we wanted our man, which was Adam Booth. And Adam Booth knows this because I've been messaging him for a year and a half. And we've got our man, and Joe's making improvements as we speak. Our decision will be warranted.
Just final word on kind of Abel Sanchez. We've also seen Gennady Golovkin leave Abel Sanchez, which is quite an acrimonious departure, exchanging a few pleasantries in the media, I think it's fair to say. Just your thoughts on that. Quite a shock to a lot of people.
it was not really a shock to me that Gennady left, because I just sensed something was happening. But it was a shock to see Gennady held himself, but Abel was obviously very, very upset, which you would be. You've treated somebody like they're your son, like you've put in all that time and effort with someone, and then he's hit the big time, and then he's left. Do you know what I mean? 100 million payday, and he's now gone to leave. So I do feel for Abel in that sense. It's not really fair, because trainers aren't really that protected, in the sense of they can take people to a huge level, they get a huge money contract, and then the fighter's just able to leave. They're not protected with anything. So I do feel for Abel on that front. And it's a sad situation, because they had a great relationship. So
going back to Joe, something that he mentioned during the press conference was a potential future fight with Tyson Fury. I know Tyson is off doing his thing in America. Yeah. Boxes June 15th against Tom Schwartz. Is that realistic? I know we saw Tyson a couple of days ago talk about potentially only having 3 fights left. Is that realistic for Joe?
Who knows? I mean, Tyson's Tyson, isn't he? Tyson, who, again, is a friend of mine, but I'm not just saying this, but I genuinely consider him the best heavyweight in the world. He beat the man who beat the man. That's just my opinion. Boxing's all about opinions. People say Joshua's the best. I believe Tyson's the number one. But if you're not in boxing to fight these men, what are you in boxing for? What is Joe's 33 years old? What is he in boxing for? You've got to want to fight the best. Tyson Fury, Joshua, Deontay Wilder. They're the fights that surely all the heavyweights, up and coming heavyweights, should want to fight. But all these heavyweights that are avoiding each other, they're pricing themselves out of these fights. I mean, Ortiz turned down $7 million to fight Anthony Joshua. That's incredible. You accept the fight, then you talk money afterwards. But that's what it is at the moment.
You mentioned that Ortiz obviously has ended up with Andy Ruiz Jr. fighting Anthony Joshua. Just tell me about that fight.
I think it's a good fight while it lasts, because I think Andy Ruiz will come to fight. I've seen him spar in Big Bear. He didn't actually spar Joe, but he's got fast hands, but only for a certain amount of time. And I think Joshua's an elite fighter, and he'll take him out spectacularly.
Final word will be on this card. Daniel DeWalvis and Nathan Gorman, we've alluded to it beforehand. Joe wasn't as brazen enough to pick a winner or who he thought would win.
Joe sparred with both of them, so he knows it's a hard fight for both. Like, Daniel's a massive puncher, Gorman's a fast hands, good mover. It's a 50-50 fight, and the fans are it's a really, really good fight.
Push you for a winner. If you had your last pound, who would you bet it on?
Say Gorman right now, because
I don't think she said that quietly, because Daniel DeBois stood over there.
No, but like right now, it's boxing brain, and but as I say, Daniel's got the power to end it in the first round. So it's all opinions. It's all opinions. I think Daniel's down as a massive favourite for the fight. So you just don't know.
Maybe make a few quid then. Jones, thanks very much for speaking to Boxing Social. Look forward to catching up with you soon.
Nice one. Thank you very much. Cheers, mate.